Yes, yes. Can y'all hear me all right? Well, greetings, my brothers and sisters. The lituation was quite exquisite last night. I am very blessed to be here, standing here in front of a lot of folks that are peers and heroes. My pastor is here, Pastor Darrell Williamson. He's here somewhere. There he is. Spiritual father, one of my living heroes. Living Faith Bible Fellowship all the way from Tampa is here. Yes. Brian Dye, I love you, brother. Thank you for how you serve with Legacy, Chicago, Heidi. I just want to be like you. If you could just teach me that, that would be awesome. Today's also my birthday. You. Feel free to bring gifts to the stage as I preach. Checks, cash, whatever you want to do, money, that's fine. Pray with me, please. Father God, we thank you so much for what you've done in this conference. Every year, I think it's been 8 years for me, I come, it becomes more and more evident that you are here, you're active. I always leave, and I know we all share that experience of wanting to go and change our cities for Jesus. We thank you, oh God, for bringing us together. We thank you, oh God, for loving us enough to gift us with your word. We ask you to bless the time that we have. Fill me with your spirit, oh God. May there be nothing that I do, trying to be prolific or entertaining, Lord. I pray all that's moved aside, that the cross would shine bright and we would be transformed. Only you can touch hearts, oh God. So I ask that you would do that. Please, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. It was about 2,000 years ago, right around the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ, that Polynesian explorers, unencumbered by the fear that the world was flat, decided to set sail and look for new territory. In their journey, they found what can only be termed as a paradise in the middle of the ocean. It was a group of islands rich in resource, filled with beaches and mountains and waterfalls, palm trees, sugar fields. It was perfect. A paradise in the middle of the Pacific. They called it Hawaii or Hawaii. There, the Polynesians established a kingdom. They were sinners, so there was conflict, but they were not like the Mayans. Okay, they were able to build a monarch that was based on a society of principles and laws, and they lived by the aloha, which was much more than a greeting, but a philosophy of life, a way of service and compassion and peace. And there they thrived for 1,500 years until some other folks showed up. Famed British explorer Captain James Cook arrived, and with him a fleet of ships, and the natives were actually happy to see them. James Cook sent one of his men to the island and was met by a native. I guess the native made a sudden move and it spooked him, and on the spot, he shot the native dead. The first contact that they had with the outside world resulted in a Hawaiian Holocaust, exterminating 95% of 800,000 natives on the island, all through guns and European diseases. However, the kingdom miraculously survived. The U.S. got involved and recognized the sovereign and independent kingdom of Hawaii. And for decades, Hawaii enjoyed friendship with the world. Until America got a little greedy and that sort of colonial conqueror instinct kicked in. And the thought was, this place is a military gold mine. And he who owns it can run the Pacific. So we got to have this. And through a process of genocide and the Gatling gun, it's hard to argue with a machine gun, and deceit and robbery and treason, they overthrew the complementary and friendly kingdom of Hawaii, bringing it to its knees. And they forced it into a U.S. territory. Hope I don't ruin your vacation, sorry. Time will not permit to go into detail, but it was devastating to the Hawaiian people. And to this day, there's fights to try to maintain what's been occupied. So you might be shocked that when I found out that missionaries played a big part in this takeover. might I add, Reformed missionaries, which I am. They left New England to preach the gospel and eventually became co-conspirators in the takeover of a people. They defended it. They enabled it. It really didn't seem to be like a spiritual problem for them in what was happening there. You see, the missionaries in the 1800s had become accustomed with exporting the gospel while exporting a Western culture. They had essentially canonized their culture so that when the Spirit canonized the scripture, it also inspired our culture. You can see the subtle signs in making styles of clothing, Western dress, Christian. You see pictures of Hawaiians on the beach. It's like 90 degrees outside and they're wearing colonial boots all the way up. You can see that they created a single way that God is honored to be intimate with your spouse. They had these subtle attitudes with the natives. They saw them as savages, human enough to be saved, but not human enough to have dignity and rights and manage their own land. They were winning folks to Christ and colonialism. Yet God was so good because folks were still getting saved. And Christianity was still spreading through the island. So I can only imagine how the natives felt when they were like, we're brothers in Christ. Why are you annexing us and forcing us out of the land? Is it weird that you're inviting us to worship on the land that you built on the blood of our people? How, Sway? How? I think the answer is the same answer, at least close related, the same reason America gave for taking over Hawaii in the first place. As I read over and over again, I saw this phrase, we must protect American interests. It's about American interests, America first. And the problem is these missionaries were merging the interests of America with the interests of God and making them one and the same. So if it's a win for America, it must be a win for God. They had put America's priorities on the same level as God's priorities. Extending the reign of our country is the same as the mission of God. Many missionaries, not all, served to be the icing on the cake of cultural genocide. But I think the scripture is fairly clear that God is not and never will be about trying to make a name for you, but a name for himself. His goal is not to make your nation great. Nothing wrong with a great nation. Praise God for that. But don't make that God's campaign. God has nothing in his word to support that. His aim is for the fame of his kingdom and the good of his people. I bring up this story because it isn't just an old frontier missions problem. It's a human problem, and it's in us. It's in the city, it's in the nation. Instead of the scripture shaping us into the image of Christ, we often shape the scripture into the image of ourselves. Though you might not have the power to ruin an entire country, you do have the power to ruin your faith, or like we learned last night, a church. We all struggle with this spirit of colonizing. Your life is not your own. You've been bought with a price. But do we often not struggle with taking what is not ours and building our own thing on top of it? Do we not struggle in the church where Jesus is somehow turned into the savior slash politician hybrid thing? Do we not struggle in the home when husbands or wives are trying to force each other into something that's more palatable for themselves instead of into the image of Jesus? So can we talk about what is God's aim? What is God's aim? And also, what is the cost of that aim? And then, how do we continue in that aim? If you have your Bibles, please turn with me to 2 Timothy, verse 10. Excuse me. Yeah, there's chapters in there too. Chapter 3, verse 10. Come on now. Come on. All right. The verse says, you, however, have followed my teaching, my conduct, my aim in life, my faith, my patience, my love, my steadfastness. Excuse me. Meaning, as Paul is making contrast here, In contrast to those who have fallen away, you, my son, have fully known my doctrine and my manner of life. You know the details. You've been with me side by side. You see how I act and my purpose in life, my faithfulness, my love for God's people. You have seen how I have never given up. You've watched it, Timothy. And this isn't a humble brag. You see, Paul directs Timothy's attention to his own life as a testament of the power of the grace of God to change a man. Faithfulness is possible. Look at Paul. Godliness is possible. Look at Paul. Holiness is possible. Look at Paul, which says to us, God's aim for you is to prove the power of God is real by leading a life that is worth following. Paul says to Timothy, I have lived so purposefully in my teaching, in my character, in my aim in life, that you have done well to be like this. You see, nobody has it all together. I understand that. But I wonder if folks were to be like me, would they just be like me? Or would being like me result in being somewhat like Jesus? I don't know what my sons are going to be. Oh, I love my boys. But I pray that when they leave my house, that they have to grapple, that it is possible. Jesus is real. I know it. How? Because I saw my daddy live it out. That's the type of testament we give to the world and that Paul is giving to Timothy. But I think the even more relevant point here that this text makes for us is the nature of pure doctrine. Note it says, you, however, have followed my teaching. Following here isn't researched or diagrammed. It literally means went after or lived out my doctrine in conduct, in aim, in life, which says to us, doctrine is not known if doctrine is not practiced. Theology and doctrine in the West has become often more about memorization, when in Scripture, it is all about imitation. It feels like often that we trade do justice and love mercy for do lectures and talk about ideas. And to be clear, it's obvious that there's nothing wrong with thinking. I'm an aspiring scholar myself. But the New Testament conveys the discipline of theology as a discipline of lifestyle. I would argue that it's not just matching your life with your doctrine. Your life is the expression of your theology. Life and doctrine must not be separate. Follow me. You must know something before you can do something. Amen. But if you do not do something, you cannot say you truly know it. Who are the purest theologians among us? Is it the brilliant minds? Or is it brilliant living? Simply obeying Jesus. It's like I see, young brother, that you have the institutes and you got a lot of books and nice seminaries behind you. God bless all of that. But can you love your neighbor? Knowledge is good. Scholarship is good. But books are no replacement for love and action. They must be partnered. Martin Luther said, when he walked through the woods, he used to raise his hat to the birds and say, good morning, theologians. You wake and sing, but I, an old fool, know less than you and worry over everything instead of simply trusting in the Heavenly Father's care. I remember when I was in Bible college, there was a man there named Mel Carter. He was the chaplain for the school. Some water would be amazing. He was the chaplain for the school. And he spent most of his life on the mission field and had retired and come to our school, and he was there to serve the student body. Los is here. I think you know who Mel Carter is. And I remember him being very, very old. He's kind of slow in terms of his movement, but he was sharp up here. He wasn't the deepest guy on campus. When you walked into his office, you didn't see 5,000 books. God bless 5,000 books in your office. I'm not hating. But I remember I would go talk to him, and I would confide in him, and I would confess sin, and I would talk about my struggle. Thank you, Brian. And I would sit down with him, and the first time I thought he was going to give me some dissertation. But he kind of encouraged me for all of 2 minutes. And then he just sat there, and here he did. He prayed. He prayed, and he would just pray for long periods of time. And let me tell you, I don't know what it was, but God always answered that man's prayers. It got to the point where I was going requesting things. My only regret is I didn't request him to pay for my student loans. If you would just ask God to do that. But I remember the thought with this brother was, this man studies God beyond paper. His study of God is alive. Paul continues this exemplary talk to Timothy. Look at verse 11. After he talks about his aim in life, as he talks about knowing his doctrine, he says in verse 11, my persecutions and sufferings that happened to me in Antioch, you know that as well. You know my persecutions and sufferings that happened to me in Antioch, in Iconium, in Lystra, which persecutions I endured, yet from them all the Lord rescued me. Meaning, not only have you seen my doctrine, how I have lived, and my aim in life, and my love, and my constancy, you've also seen me suffer. Which escalates things a bit. It pivots from the previous more positive examples in Paul's life and it moves to his hardships. Timothy, look, God by his Spirit has kept me. You've seen what we have brought to the world, but the world has brought something back to us in return. Shame. In Antioch, persecution and afflictions. Folks worked hard to contradict him. In Iconium, unbelieving Jews and Gentiles assaulted him. They tried to stone him to death. In Lystra, stoned again, taken out of the city and left for dead. Paul could not have been a good-looking dude. He was stoned a lot. And that's just to name a few. Timothy lived in those areas, so he was able to see this. He must have seen the blood on the ground. He must have heard of the rejections, heard the rumors. Yet Paul says, I am unashamed. 2 Timothy is probably the last letter Paul writes before he is beheaded by the state. It is written in a dungeon and Paul finds himself friendless, abandoned, poor, and physically uncomfortable. The scripture says that implies that he was cold. He didn't even have a coat to his name. And though to many the great apostle looked weak and defeated, chained as a criminal, there was not an ounce of shame in that jail cell. Because who the Son sets free is free indeed, and you can't incarcerate faith. And I'm sorry. You ever wonder if Paul had an Instagram? This is just things going on in my brain. If Paul had, I don't know how he would run his Instagram. I mean, you get out of jail, you know, Al Sharpton, you know, hashtag apostle, hashtag suffer. I don't know. I don't know. But there is a reason that nobody's life is as good as they make it seem on Instagram. Because the world has told us what the flaws are, and then they offer a plethora of products to edit those flaws out. But Paul purposefully leaves all the things that they call flaws in the Insta story. This is what it says to us. Though the world throws shame, do not be shamed. Unashamed is the aim. Timothy has an unedited, unfiltered picture of what it actually means to follow Jesus, but he wants Timothy to look at it and to wrestle with it and realize about no matter what they're saying about what happened in Antioch and what happened in Iconium and what happened in Lystra, these are not flaws in my ministry. That's what they're going to call it, but God uses that for an opportunity to flex. Look at the end of that verse. Look at the end of that verse. It says, but out of them all, the Lord delivered me, meaning he came for me every single time. It reminds me of the three Hebrew boys that were thrown into a furnace. And when they get into the furnace, refusing to bow to any God besides Jehovah, they were prepared to die in there, but they trusted God would deliver them. They looked inside this furnace and they see a fourth being in there. It was God. God was with the boys there. But note that God doesn't save us from the furnace, because there is more glory if he saves us in the furnace. And if we die, we are still secure. For whom do I have in heaven but you? There is none on this earth that I desire besides you. My heart, my flesh, my friends, my family all may fail, but you, God, are my strength and my portion forever. You will deliver me by my right hand, by your right hand, into glory. They can kill us, but they cannot hurt us. What trouble can they bring to you that he will not see you through? And he has to, brothers and sisters. Because Timothy, you and everybody that wants to be like you will suffer. Look at verse 12. It says, indeed, all who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. Which says to us, persecution is not an option for the godly. All who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. Meaning, not potential or possibility, that is nothing unique about the apostle or the pastor. It's all of us who are in the faith. Everyone who desires to live for Christ Jesus, they will experience pushback. Why? The Jesus of the Bible is offensive, brothers and sisters. An emphasis on the Jesus of the Bible. Because if you out there acting a fool, representing some other Jesus, then, you know, the Bible says a fool's mouth invites a beating. So maybe you might need, I don't know. Jesus of the Bible, the real Jesus. And when you tell people they need to be forgiven, you realize that there's an accusation in there. Oh, you're saying I'm a sinner. When you say that Jesus is Lord, of who? Of me? Well, what are you trying to say? What does that mean about all the other religions in the world? It's kind of narrow. Godly living in Christ Jesus is irritating to the flesh, yours and the world, because resisting sin hurts. It's a type of suffering. And then in the world, darkness cannot comprehend the light. The Bible says that men love the dark and won't come to the light lest their deeds be exposed. Nobody wants to be around righteousness like that. Nobody wants to be around a silent yet continual reminder that they are at odds with a holy God. It's irritating. You're out there giving away your money. You're sharing the good gospel, but it's very inconvenient. Holding off, being pure. Saving your sex for marriage. I've literally seen people lose their mind over that thought. What do you mean? I could never feel how scandalous forgiving your enemies were until I had enemies of my own. Or better yet, when I went to Liberia with my pastor and we were in a village 18 hours into Liberia, into the jungle, and we were standing before a congregation of women where 90% of the women in that audience had been raped at some point in their life. And to think that maybe the person who has done this is probably still in the neighborhood. And we talk about forgiveness. It is shocking. It is radical. And it is altogether not cool to the world. Christian artists, we shouldn't be shocked when a dark mainstream is running from what we do. Godly living prevents us from pouring ungodliness in our music. But it's not really what we are saying about Jesus, because a little bit of Jesus in hip hop is cool. But it really is what we refuse to say that makes us distinct. We refuse to talk about strippers. We refuse to talk about trap houses. We refuse to talk about lean unless we're calling people to redemption. That is irritating. Beloved, if we have figured out a way to share Jesus with people without it bothering them, we have figured out something that not even Jesus himself could do. If you desire to be godly in your life, in your business, in your career, watch out. Now, that does not mean that if you experience success in the mainstream or you know, things are going well for you when people ain't running around beating you with a stick or something like that, that you're in sin. I literally had a brother the other day tell me, I don't know if it was a brother, but he told me the other day, he said, when the last time you've been to jail, KB, for the gospel? I went last week. Yeah. Said, first of all, take two steps back. The idea is to arm yourself, brothers and sisters. Not all of us are called to die a martyr's death, but we are all called to have the same spirit of self-sacrifice. So, Timothy, be not discouraged. Nobody likes pains, bro. Nobody likes pain, brothers and sisters. Well, no sane person likes pain. We don't like looking weak and corny. It's not fun. But we love Jesus more and we enjoy the fellowship of our God who is always with us, even if the world leaves us. Often I'll go jogging through my neighborhood and I got my Beats on and I just got the Bluetooth ones, man. So I don't even have a cord. So I can just vibe while I'm running. Sometimes I'll stop and hit a nice little shadow box and I'll start, you know, new Andy comes out and I'm rapping the words and stuff like that. And my neighbors are looking at me like, what is wrong with him?
And I'm like, what's wrong with you? If you could hear how crazy this music was, you'd be turning up too. Richard Wurmbrand said that those who are with Jesus in suffering hear this music to which other men are deaf. But we dance and do not care if we are considered insane. Think it not strange, family. And woe to those who would try to avoid. Looking at verse 13. Timothy, you and all those who live godly will suffer persecution, while evil people and imposters will go on from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. It's that form of godliness, a profession of Christian faith. But if you just have the form and not the power, you can absolutely eliminate persecution. And Paul calls that evil. Paul is saying it seems like it makes sense to try to avoid the persecution that comes your way. But you're not actually moving towards safety. You're moving towards danger. Bad to worse literally means to advance in the direction of worse, which says to us that the persecution-free life is not a better life. They will make this faith and its purity more palatable, less edgy. My pastor always says they'll try to pad the cross, defang the sting of discipleship, crowns with no crosses. And it will deceive people. And maybe it's not even intentional, but it is deceit. And Paul uses the word imposters because he's saying that this is not something that's going to be like happening outside in the world. It's those who want to have the form of godliness. They want to be identified with the Christian faith. They're the ones that are profiting for having just enough godliness to get in. That these individuals will push this message. One thing that Dallas Willard used to say was, the people in these last days, we're referring to the people in the last days in this context here, but he would say, they'll become like Christian vampires, wanting Jesus for his blood, but never for his life. Verse 14 says, but as for you, continue in what you have learned and have firmly believed, knowing from whom you learned it and how from childhood you have been acquainted with the sacred writings, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. That'll preach by itself. God's aim is that we stay. Nothing gives perspective, brothers and sisters, on life like when you're reaching its end. Again, at the end of his life, Paul is talking to his spiritual son, Timothy, and he's not doing that sort of traditional, I want you to avoid all the stuff that I did, brother, okay? Here are the codes. You don't want to end up in jail and penniless and cold. No, Paul says to Timothy, join me. Come get in on this. Just like I have endured, you endure, my son, for it is what I have endured that has shaped me into a man that is ready for glory. This is the blessed life, bruh. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when men revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. So, Timothy, legacy, continue. And let's think about it. The text is not very clear in the English, but that word continue in the Greek literally means to remain in. You see, your faith is complete already. It doesn't need to become more compelling. It doesn't need to develop into something else. You just need to develop in it. Paul says, hold to what you have learned from childhood. The stuff that you got 30 years ago, if it was Jesus stuff, it's still good today. Another interpretation for that word deceiver in the previous verses is the word jugglers or magician. These people who are literally entertaining new things so that making people depart from that which was old. You remain, stay back. Imposters get bored and move on. You stay. Paul says, Timothy, our faith is inexhaustible. It's always new. It's always fresh. Don't try to keep up with the time. God is ahead of time. God is behind time. God is over time. And if you stay with him, you will always be relevant, sir. Yeah. Jeremiah 6:16 says, walk in the old path, for there is life. Continue in what you have learned. Why? Verse 15. Because you have been given the sacred scriptures that are able to make you wise through salvation. Oh, that's what keeps our aim aligned. That's what keeps our aim aligned with his glory. And here's my last thought, and I am done. Obsession over what God says keeps us on God's mission. Like the psalmist, he says, how can a young man keep his way pure? How do I keep my doctrine pure? How do I keep my mission pure? How do I make sure I'm not going off into a bunch of added things to the gospel and oppressing folks? He says, by guarding it according to the word. Verse 16 says, all scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness, so that the man or woman of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. Meaning all scripture, front to back, comes from the divine breath. We know that Greek word, theopneustos. Tadashi said it in a song one time. It's like, man, it wasn't Greek in his music. That's tight. Just as the air is carrying my words through the microphone to your ears, God, like nowhere else, is speaking through the Spirit, and the breath of God carries the word of God to our hearts. 40 authors with different levels of education, different experiences, different perspectives. They all sit down and write, and God does not just give them good ideas. He literally hovers over them, and he makes sure that everything is straight, like a divine flute player. He is playing the life and the experience and the education of the author, and it's coming out as perfect music, so that whenever they speak, God is speaking. I've been so challenged by the way I have often approached this book. It becomes common, routine, monotonous. And that's not how Paul wants us to think about it. He wants to think about it as sacred. The sacred scriptures hallow the truth in this book. This is God's speech. He is our favorite theologian, a man named Dr. Frame. We love him down in Tampa. He's helped me realize how profound it is that we serve a speaking God. Listen, just as much as love and omniscience and eternality are attributes of God, so is God's speech. It is an attribute of his nature. Notice, when scripture distinguishes God from all false gods, why? Because God speaks and they don't. The idols are called dumb and mute. The Father, the speaker in creation, he speaks everything into existence. The Son, the Logos, the Word of God, the Spirit, the breath of God that carries the Word of God to our hearts. God identifies himself as Lord, and we are to worship the name of the Lord. His words are the object of our worship because they reveal the very nature, the very being of Almighty God. Do you miss his presence? I miss his presence. As much as I am present right now with my vocals, as you're hearing them, God is present with his words in scripture. He's right there. God always speaks in person. Frame puts it like this: when we read the word, we encounter God, and when we encounter God, we hear his word. Oh, if you feel far from God, Paul is saying, this is where you got to go. It is God's word that heals. It saves, delivers. It's created everything, holds everything together. His acts of redemption are his speech. God saved my life. He saved your life when he called you. The voice of God shakes the earth to its core. It's in his decrees. It's his providence. It's judgment. All of it is speech. We must listen. Oh, that says something powerful about this Bible that we get to carry in our backpacks and have on our phone. Does it feel like we're stepping in the holy ground when we open it? Oh, if it doesn't, we must believe it. It cannot be dull. It's not dull. The other day I had a show in Chicago, actually, about a month ago. And I brought my team up. It was me, Al, my drummer, Mo, and my road manager, Jimmy. And after the show, of course, we had to get some Chicago pizza. So we ate at Luminati's, as Brian's favorite. And they brought the Luminati's to us. And I ate a slice. It was amazing. I thank God for it. But my road manager, Jimmy, he bit into the pizza. And he said, and I quote, "This isn't better than Little Caesars." I literally, God is my witness, I literally was on the phone with my wife, and I said, hold on, baby, hold on, one second. In fact, I'm gonna call you right back. I'm gonna call you right back. Yes. All right, okay, bye. What did you say? And I said to him, I said, "Brother, there is nothing wrong with the pizza. There's something wrong with your taste buds." Brothers and sisters, there's nothing wrong with the flavor of this book. It's just something wrong with our taste buds to savor it. Believe that. God's word does not return to him, and I'm finishing. It does not return to him void. Why? Because he is with his words. He will find his target. It will bring home his man. In Hawaii, in colonization, in chattel slavery, the voice of God was still able to be discerned through all the chaos and all the impurity and all the merging of interests. Many came to know Jesus sincerely apart from though who was oppressing them. The gospel still breaks through in those situations because his word will come back with the purpose it was sent out with. The aim of missions is to echo God's voice to the world, which is profitable in every scenario known to man. It teaches us truth from error. It gives us doctrine that doesn't contradict. When missionaries went out believing the doctrine of discovery that was given them by the Pope, where they will organize people's value in terms of white, red, and black, determining who can have dominion over the land. You see, the doctrine of creation, which is actually in the Bible, if submitted to, would have crushed that type of thinking, because the Bible clearly makes it plain to us that you cannot give people dignity. They already have it. You just have to affirm it. Every man has the right to take dominion over this land. It rebukes us. He is Lord. We are not. When was the last time that I was rebuked and was thankful for it? The Bible isn't just trying to tolerate you. It wants to transform you. Its rebukes are love. It corrects us. The Bible does not exist for us to find things in it to affirm what we already believe, but to transform us and bring us continually back to the path, beginning again. It trains us in righteousness, and last part of that verse, so that every man and every woman of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. We are not saved by works, but we are saved for good works. To take the good gospel, the good peace of a good God to a dying world, so that when it's all said and done, we can say with Paul, "I have fought the good fight. I got no regrets. I have finished the course. I have kept the faith, not perfect, but perpetual, faithful. In the future, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. And not only to me, but also to all who have loved him." Let's pray. Father, your grace is amazing. Open our eyes to see it, O Lord. Keep us from the evil one. May we lean in to your truth, no matter the cost. Help us to know your aim. Help us to follow it. And send us out on mission, oh God, in a way that glorifies the true Jesus, the real Jesus, the Jesus of your God-breathed word. We love you. Amen.